Aren't pseudogenes evidence for evolution? Welcome to Critical Thinking Scan, where we look at how you can think about any faith-challenging message and arrive at a biblical, logical conclusion yourself. I'm Patricia Engler, and today let's look at the claim that mutations in shared pseudogenes in chimps and humans support the idea that they descended from a common ancestor. Pseudogenes are non-coding DNA sequences which look like certain genes, but with differences believed to be mutations. The idea is pseudogenes resulted from protein-coding genes which lost their original functions or were accidentally copied somewhere along the evolutionary family tree, letting the extra copy accumulate mutations to become a pseudogene. So, if different kinds of organisms, say chimps and humans, have similar pseudogenes with the same mutations in the same spots, that's considered great evidence that chimps and humans share a common ancestor who had those mutations as well. Because statistically speaking, you wouldn't expect identical random mistakes to happen twice. So, do pseudogenes demonstrate evolution? Let's think about it. Critical thinking check number one is check scripture. And Genesis explains that God created everything very good. So we wouldn't expect God to design completely useless genes, much less put them in multiple organisms. Still, we know creation didn't stay very good because of sin, so we wouldn't be surprised to see corruptions of originally good genes through mutations. Biblically then, we'd expect pseudogenes either serve some function or lost their original functions. But we wouldn't interpret them as evolutionary leftovers because that would contradict a clear teaching of scripture, which is check number two, check the challenge. Jumping down to check number five, check for propaganda, we can apply the question, is this message true or false because, to ask, is it true that pseudogenes have no function because we don't know what their function is? And like we saw with other types of so-called junk DNA, the answer is no. Saying pseudogenes are useless because we don't understand their use would be an appeal to ignorance fallacy. On to check six, check the interpretations. What's the observational science about pseudogenes? What facts can we observe right now? The fact is that different organisms have some similar non-coding DNA sequences, which themselves look similar to certain coding DNA sequences. The interpretation from historical sciences is that these non-coding sequences are largely useless evolutionary leftovers. So, what are some assumptions behind this explanation? Besides assuming that one kind of creature can evolve into another and that evolution can produce genes in the first place, it's assuming that pseudogenes are non-functional and that the same mistakes wouldn't happen in the same place twice. To see if these assumptions are valid, we have to dig deeper into the observational science. You can do that in much more detail through the resources linked to this video. But to give you an idea, the more researchers discover, the clearer it's becoming that many so-called pseudogenes are functional. In fact, part of the reason why they might look like coding genes may be that RNA transcribed from them helps to regulate those coding genes. Recent ENCODE data lists pseudogenes as a category of functional RNA-binding sequences. Some pseudogenes might even be coding genes expressed only in certain tissues under certain conditions, making their functions harder to detect. Now, some researchers apply evolutionary assumptions to say that pseudogenes must have evolved such functions after the fact, although a study which looked for evidence of this didn't find much. The researchers concluded that because they didn't see much evidence for more functional motifs evolving in pseudogenes, pseudogenes must not have functions. But again, that's an interpretation based on evolutionary assumptions. The observations remain that pseudogenes play numerous roles, as multiple other studies document. Now, what about the assumption that the same mutation wouldn't happen twice in the same place? Actually, as you can learn in more detail elsewhere, particular regions of DNA sequences seem to be hotspots for certain types of mutations. So, assuming these differences between genes and pseudogenes are mutations, it wouldn't necessarily be unreasonable for them to appear in multiple organisms. For instance, the fact that humans and apes have similar mutations in Gulo pseudogenes supposedly means they share a common ancestor. But humans and guinea pigs also share 36% of the same Gulo mutations, showing that similar mutations do appear in different lineages. Besides, in many cases, the fact that organisms display similar pseudogenes hints that these sequences do have functions. ultimately, a biblical interpretation that pseudogenes represent useful designs or information losses makes sense of the observational science and requires no evolutionary explanation. For more on how to think critically about faith-challenging messages, you can access my other CT scan videos packed with tactics, tips, and tools that helped me as a Christian student at secular university. Thank you for watching. Hey, it's Patricia here. Just wanting to let you know that if you like these videos, a free, easy way to help Ancestors in Genesis Canada create more content and equip more people to defend their faith is to hit that like button, subscribe to our channel, click the bell, and of course, share these resources. That lets the social media algorithms help these videos reach more people who can benefit from them, saving us advertising expenses while promoting biblical authority. Thank you so much.